Let's see if we can get lyrics up for our first song here.
To welcome all of you. Happy Sabbath. Well, that wasn't very joyous. This is the Sabbath, a very joyous day. Once again, happy Sabbath. So happy to see you all and hear you. So now Uncle Andy will come up for some announcements.
have a few announcements. Most of these can be found on the newsletter that you should be getting on your email. If you haven't been getting the email, then please let Pastor Seth or Pastor Enoch know. On April 30th, 6 p.m., we're going to have a business meeting, so please mark that on your calendar, April 30th, 6 p.m., with food, and then from 7 p.m. we'll be having business meeting. April 25, and all of May, Halekokua has a ping pong night, ping pong, so we are looking for a church member who would be able to be here to kind of mingle with people and monitor things. So if you are able to do that on April 25th, that's this coming Thursday, and sometime in May, you don't have to pick up all the shifts, but any shift that you might be able to pick up, if you could let LaVonda know, that would be great. We will be having a hike today at 2:30, 3 p.m. Plan is to hike near Pali. There's a waterfall up Pali Highway, so we will gather here around 2:30. So if you're able to make it, we would love to have you guys join. If you've noticed, there's a lot of books and bookcases in the back in Kona Hall. Please feel free to pick them up, especially the bookcases. They're all free. Let Pastor know if you want to pick them up. Next week, Women's Ministry is planning on a social. There'll be more announcements coming, but it'll be next Saturday evening. Lastly, but not least, especially for me, corn dogs, April 24th. These are so good. When I saw that there was limited supply, I put in a lot for myself, not for my kids, all for me. It's going to be 24th Wednesday, 4 to 7 p.m. is going to be the pickup time. The proceeds will be going to Handbill Ministry, where they're practicing up here. After worship service, usually they're up here practicing and sounding very nice. So that is it for announcement. I want to turn it back to the worship praise team. Thank you. Thank you.
assume a posture of reverence that's best for you, sitting, standing, kneeling as I pray. Lord, we just thank you for this beautiful Sabbath morning, that you've brought all of us here, that we may rejoice in your name and be glad, for this is a day that you have made. And I just thank you for all your blessings and this beautiful Sabbath morning. And I ask that as we are going to give up the offering next, that we give out of our hearts and with hearts of giving. We thank you for your sacrifice and your unending love. In your name I pray, amen. This time, the ushers will come forward and take up offering as we sing It Is Well.
Thank you.
sing together the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above in heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son,
George will come.
I get the pleasure of doing the children's story today, so young folks, come on up and take a seat up front. Boys and girls, how many of you like playing around water? Lakes, rivers, oceans, swimming. I love being around the water. You know what I like doing most about in around the water? Fishing. I love fishing. And when we were young, my dad took us fishing a lot. We were up in Canada. They didn't have oceans up there where we lived, but they had lots and lots of lakes, and we were able to do a lot of fishing. We would wake up really early in the morning before sun came up, and then we would be up there fishing, and then afterwards in the afternoon we would be swimming. It was so much fun. Well, I'm going to tell you a story. When I was 10 years old, my brothers and I, we were living for the weekends going fishing. One day, however, after school, my dad noticed that all of us boys, our hair was getting a little long, and he said, "You boys, it's time to go to your mom and get your hair cut." My mom cut hair at that time, and I didn't like getting my hair cut. It's not like my mom did a bad job or anything, but I just didn't like getting my hair cut. I just like to have my ears covered, you know? I didn't like that. So I said, "Dad, I don't want to get my hair cut. I'd rather have it this way." And then my dad was stern that day. He said, "No, you gotta get your hair cut. Remember, you gotta be clean and you gotta get your hair cut." And I didn't want to argue with that, but I got really angry. I don't remember why I got so angry. So I went in my room, slammed the door, and I said, "I'm so angry, what should I do?" And then before I knew it, I saw Dad's fishing rod in the corner, and I grabbed it, and oh man. I went like this, and I go, "I'm so mad." And it go, "Oh." Before I knew it, my dad's fishing rod was broken, and I was shocked, and I go, "Oh man, what should I do now?" And I put it back in behind the curtain, and I said, "I hope he doesn't notice it." Of course he's gonna notice it. And sure enough, several weeks later, Dad said, "I think we can go fishing this weekend." And my brothers were going, "Yay!" And guess what I was doing? "Oh no, he's gonna discover that fishing rod that is broken." And then, so sure enough, he was packing this fishing rod, and he said, "Oh, look, my fishing rod is broken. Boys, what happened? Do you know anything about my fishing rod? What happened?" And my brothers go, "No." My younger brother goes, "No." And I go, "No." And then he goes, okay. And I thought, okay, so he believed me. Maybe he'll just buy a new fishing rod and that'll be it. I didn't know that my dad was very, very good with crafts, and he went ahead and got some special glue and some nylon string, and he fixed the thing like this. And he actually got another tape and then put it together. It looked kind of funny, but it worked. And he went fishing with it for many years. Every time I saw that fishing rod, I felt bad. I go, you should have confessed long ago, right away, that you were angry, and out of my anger, you broke his fishing rod. But I was ashamed. And the longer I waited, the harder it became. You know how long I waited before I eventually, the good news is I did say something eventually. It took 3 years for me to get courage to say it. So one day after school, I said, I'm gonna have to tell Dad, I'm gonna have to confess because this is bothering me. You know who's been telling me, George, you should make it right? The Holy Spirit, you know, God was telling me. And I went up to his room after he finished work, and I said, Dad, I've been holding on to this secret for a long, long time, and it's been bothering me so long that I have to tell you, I was the one that broke your fishing rod 3 years ago. I'm not sure if you remember. He goes, oh, I said, I feel real bad, I'm so sorry. And he goes, oh, he looked at me, smiled, and said, that's okay, son. It must have been bothering you for a long time. I'm glad you said that. I love you. And I go, oh, that was it. I felt like it was a huge load was off my back, and I felt so good, and I was so happy that I was able to experience Dad's forgiveness and his love, and that I can see Dad much happier now. And since that time, I learned that if you ever make a mistake and you need to say something to say sorry, it's easiest to say sorry right away, not to wait. Yeah, and also not to be so angry that you have to do something real bad, right? Yeah, there's lots of things you can do when you're upset. But this story reminded me of the story in the Bible. Do you remember after Jesus died and was resurrected, that Peter and his disciples went fishing? And then they couldn't fish, they couldn't catch any fish all night, and then in the morning, they saw a man at on the shore saying, friends, did you catch any fish? And they said, no, we've been fishing all night, didn't catch anything. He goes, why don't you cast a net on the other side? And guess who that man was? Do you know? Jesus, yeah, Jesus. So Peter, of course, the net was full of fish, and they were shocked, but then Peter discovered that it was Jesus. He recognized it was Jesus. And he jumped in the water, swam to the shore, and wanted to be the first one to be with Jesus. After they had breakfast, Jesus and Peter had a conversation. Because you remember, before Jesus died, Peter denied Jesus 3 times. He goes, I don't know this man. And that made Jesus really, really sad. Well, in that conversation after breakfast, I'm sure they had a good heart-to-heart talk, and Jesus allowed Peter to say, I love you 3 times, for the 3 times he denied him. And their relationship was restored. Peter received experience of forgiveness and Jesus' love. So that story reminded me of my experience with the broken fishing rod. So boys and girls, God loves you when you're good, and God loves you when you're bad, but he wants us to have a good relationship with him, and with others too, each other. So please remember to always tell the truth. If you make a mistake, it's okay. You can confess and make it right with each other right away, okay? All right, so let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love and your forgiveness. Help us to always be true to you and to each other. Give us the power and the courage to do so every day. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, time for you to collect your offering for Little Lamb's offering, okay?
you look in the bulletin, there is no special music. we were advised or told, hey, if you guys want to do a special music, you can. There is no special music for today, so we figured, why not? So let's play this, let's sing together this song. I'm sure that I just looked a little bit briefly to the what we're gonna hear this morning, and looks like, you know, there are people like myself praying, and I'm praying harder, and somebody else is getting blessed, and I'm wondering why am I praying harder and somebody else is getting blessed. And anyway, so in life we go through up and downs, and like the song says, you know, sometimes you're in the valley and sometimes you are in front of a mountain that you gotta. And God gives us the strength to just go.
Press on. Amen. That was beautiful. Thank you. Sometimes it's a blessing not to have a planned special music. Well, good morning, everybody. Glad you could be here to worship with us this morning. It's always a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. It's always a blessing to learn about the character of God, which is what we have been doing the past number of weeks, especially during this Bible lab. We're halfway through. Today will be our seventh study of 13. So if you've missed some of the previous ones, we always have... We have copies in the back for you, so as you're leaving, if you want to get caught up or if you missed one or five, go ahead and take one of the studies with you, and you can tune in online and look through the study as you look online and be blessed that way. If you have not been a part of this service before, you'll notice that you have interaction cards. These are something that we encourage you to use during the service. I cannot force you. But it does make it more meaningful and more fun if you participate in the questions and the answers. So there's a yes, no, and maybe card, and then there's a love it card if you don't want to say anything, but you want to say, I love what that person is sharing right now. It's meaningful. Or there's the question or comment card. If you do raise your question or comment card, you will receive one of these beautiful things right here so that we can all hear the comment that God has brought to your heart and to your mind. So without further ado, what I'd like to do is just pause just for a moment, because as we all know, life can be hectic, busy, all of that. We come rushing into Sabbath and we say, yay, it's time for a break. But sometimes we don't slow down. It's hard. In fact, sometimes by the end of the day, we're like, oh, I'm just starting to relax. And then it's time for another week. So let's just take just a moment right now to invite God to speak to us personally. Take a deep breath and let kind of those things kind of fade away, the troubles and the difficulties of life. Father God, we are here to experience your presence this morning. We know that you're here already. We know that you arrived before we came this morning. We know that you will not leave, because you will be enjoying just sitting in the quietness, remembering the things that we have been learning and sharing and growing with today. Lord, we know that you gave us your word so that we might have life and to have it more abundantly. We know that you came to be that word, Jesus, the word. And so we pray that you will show us the way. We pray that today, as we listen to your voice through the stories that you told while you were here on this earth, that we can get a clearer picture of your character. And just now, as we pause for a moment, we want to just surrender all to you and accept you into this time and space. Thank you, Lord. We're excited to see what you have to show us today. All of God's people said, amen. All right, so we have a couple mics here. We have one on this side, and then maybe Seth, if you can catch people here in the front, maybe sit over here in the middle somewhere. That way I'm not too distracted. Anyway, today we have some fun questions for you. All right, so get out your yes, no, maybe cards, your yes, no, maybe cards. And the first question is, I'm a harder worker than the person sitting next to me. Yes, no, or maybe. I'm a harder worker than the person sitting next to me. All right, hold them high. I got to see them. Wow, we literally have a very mixed group today. We've got, well, maybe fewer yeses than nos, but it's almost an even split three ways. So, yeah, good. All right, next question. If you don't work, you don't eat. Yes, no, or maybe. If you don't work, you don't eat. All right. We got a few maybes, okay, a few more, all right. We got a few no's. Yeah, and then we have, I don't know, maybe half of those that raised their cards, 40% or so, said yes. If you don't work, you don't eat. All right. Number three, we should all get paid the same, regardless of our education, work ethic, or productivity. Why am I seeing so many no's? Okay, we have a socialist here in the back. No, I'm kidding. I'm teasing. Oh, wow. Maybe she's got a little head start on us. Oh, we got a few maybes. All right. Yeah, it's a tricky question sometimes. All right, number four. I don't understand why God blesses some people who don't work as hard as me. I don't understand why God blesses some people that don't work as hard as me. This one's a little more difficult, but what do you think? No? All right, so you do understand why God blesses some people who don't work as hard as you. Oh, okay, and some maybes. All right. I think if we're honest, we probably at least struggle with that at one point in our life or another, where we say, man, I'm over here, you know, putting all I got, and I'm barely connecting the dots, right? And then you see someone who's maybe just chilling and collecting whatever, whether it's inheritance or something else, and say, ah, they have it easy, right? It's not fair. All right, number five, God is unfair. Yes, no, or maybe. God is unfair. Yes, no, or maybe. So, for the record, let me point out there's about 90% that say no, and there's only a few that say yes. Wow. All right. This is going to be a fun story today. All right, so get out your question and comment cards, because I'd really love to have your feedback on this. It's kind of a funny one, though. Is God fair? And you can't help but think, I've heard this phrase before, and in fact, Roy Ice, who began the Bible Labs, shared it this way. He said, you know, if God were fair, and he took that really literally, we'd have a lot of blind, toothless people. An eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. Yeah, we'd have a lot of people eating baby food and walking around blind. All right, so thankfully God is not fair in that regards. But God is not fair. Why not? We're going to explore that today. So let me start by asking you this question. This is a question or comment card, so have your comments ready. What are some of the things that can get you to grumble the most in your workplace? What are some of the things that get you to grumble the most in your workplace? No grumblers out there. Next to godliness out here. All right. Okay, we got a comment over here. When someone's not pulling their weight. Ethan, do you have a mic? Oh, it's hiding. Okay, cool. All right, so he just shouted it out there. We'll get you a mic next time. We have a comment back here. Yeah, when someone's not pulling their weight, that'll really get you going. All right, we have a mic coming to you, Steve.
When you think you see favoritism going on.
Okay. Favoritism. All right. Yeah. Not pulling your weight, favoritism over here on the side.
When your coworkers are grumpy.
Oh, okay. So it's easy to grumble when your coworkers are grumpy. Well, but you won't talk to them about it. You'll go and tell your friends, right? Like, oh, they're so grumpy. Right? Yeah. Okay, good. Right here.
When my boss bosses me around.
God? Okay. Right here.
Don't get paid enough.
Oh, don't get paid enough. Yeah, all right. So maybe you got a difficult boss like Seth has. Or you don't get paid enough for all the work that you're doing. Question, comment. Any others? Oh, you guys got great jobs, great work. Oh, you got one here? Titus, right here.
I guess it's never good enough. You do your best and there is no appreciation. Like, so I'm learning that, you know, even with the guys that, so I'm trying to like, okay, good, today good. But, you know, I experienced it a lot in the past. Like, how much more should I do in order for you to be happy? Never happy, never enough.
Never, yeah. So never hitting the mark. Yeah, that one's hard. So instead of, you know, sometimes we say, yeah, great job, but, right? So it kind of takes away the compliment anyways when you're the one that's the employer, yeah. But saying, great job, and this is how you could do it better, all right? We like the and word. Okay, go ahead, Auntie Wilma.
When I used to work, we would have, you know, staff meetings, and then the head of the staff would promise this, promise that.
Uh-oh.
Be sure the supplies are in, be sure workflow is smooth, and then it doesn't come true. And we have to have another staff meeting straighten out what we thought was straightened out before. So unfulfilled promises.
Yeah, yeah, kind of the expectations and promises and things just not working out the way that we want them to. Yeah, yeah. Good. No more? So we're going to dig into this a little bit this morning. We're going to go through the filter of Scripture, and then you'll have plenty to grumble about. So we'll have another opportunity for you to grumble and complain as we go through the Scripture this morning. Matthew chapter 20. So turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 20, and we're going to look at the story for today. Now, you can't find this story. You know, Christ tells this parable, but you can't find it in Mark, Luke, or John. It's only unique here to Matthew, all right? Matthew chapter 20, and we'll start in verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. If you don't have a Bible, there should be one in front of you, or you also probably have a phone that has a Bible on it. So I invite you to follow along, because there's a lot of really cool key things that we can learn from the story, well, from anywhere in the Bible, but specifically the story we're looking at this morning. So, kingdom of heaven, like a landowner, went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. Now, when he had agreed with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour and saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, I will give you." So they went. Again, he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour and did likewise. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing idle and said to them, "Why have you been standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one hired us." And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, you will receive." So when evening had come, the owner of the vineyard said to his steward, "Call the laborers and give them their wages, beginning with the last to the first." And when those who came who were hired about the 11th hour, they received each a denarius. But when the first came, they supposed that they would receive more, and they likewise received each a denarius. And when they had received it, they complained against the landowner, saying, "These last men have worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden and the heat of the day?" But he answered one of them and said, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go your way. I wish to give this last man the same as you. Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with my own things? Or is your eye evil because I am good? So the last will be first, and the first last. For many are called, but few are chosen." All right. Let's discuss this for a few minutes. You should have a few more things to complain about. Yeah, some of you are giving me the wide eyes and nods. Yes. What bothers you the most about this parable? How do we typically apply this within the church? What bothers you about this, and how do we usually apply it? Comments, questions? Okay, all right, boy, we got people shouting out today. All right, it just doesn't seem fair. That's all right. It just doesn't seem fair. That's a good one. What else? Any other comments or questions after looking at this story? Oh, let's get you a mic.
Now, I don't know for sure how it applies to the church, but to society, which is obvious because some of the biblical principle is not easily accepted by modern society. I mean, in a capitalist society like America, people emphasize on fairness. If I put in so much hours, I want to get paid more than the other who just put in a couple of hours.
Sure.
And so it is not fair. The whole Bible is not fair. I mean, if you look at the Old Testament, especially being a non-Jewish person, I mean, why does God, or why did God favor the Jewish people so much more than the other people? And I think this is something that makes us think and perhaps go deeper into the deeper meaning of the Bible. Because I think there is an answer to it.
Yeah. And that's what we're trying to do right now, right, is what is it that Jesus is trying to point out about the character of God? He's clearly trying to communicate something to us that is countercultural. And you're right, that's the culture we live in today, right? You work harder, you get paid more, right? You want the bigger house? Well, you got to work for it. Yeah, it's not going to get given to you, of course. Other questions, comments?
I guess it depends where we apply. Yeah. So if it's church, if it's work, if I tell my guys, hey guys, if you know, you get paid the same, you know, then everybody gonna show up at 3:30, say, oh, I'm here. So I expect to get paid for the day, you know.
Yeah.
So I couldn't do that. Yeah. So I, you know, so then I have to be just like you came late today, so you only get this much.
But right.
So, you know, it is unfair from this perspective, yeah. So if I was there, one of these guys, I would say, that's not right.
It's not right, yeah.
I wish I came, you know, just sit around all day and then come here for the last hour and collect as much as you, you know, everybody else.
Right, right. Nobody's going to be in the marketplace until 4 o'clock tomorrow or 5 o'clock tomorrow, yeah. Okay, yeah, comment right here.
Okay, well, there's also, we also have to think about, what if those people that didn't get a job, what if they've been wanting a job, but they said that nobody offered them a job? So maybe they weren't just sitting around. Maybe they wanted to have a job.
Ooh, yes.
The character of God in Acts 10:34 says, Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. So maybe it's not fair, but he is just.
Ah, so is there a difference between being fair and being just? We have a question in the very back there. Oh, okay, yep, that's fine. And then we have one back there too. Yes. Oh, you know what, I think it's off. Can you click it on the bottom, just a quick tap? We don't see that in the story, do we?
They probably loved it.
I think they took off quick before he realized what he had done. Yeah. Paid him a full day's wage for an hour of work. Oh, it's not about the workers. All right, you're a man before your time. We're going to get there. Okay, yes, right there in the back.
My question is, the last statement, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Is that anywhere else in Scripture?
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, where is that, and what is that reference?
Ah, does anybody else remember where that is in Scripture? The first will be last, and the last first. Somebody can even Google it there. Where else do we see that? What other story? There's another story. Do you remember it? No. What story is it? Somebody's got to do the work. The first last and the last first. All right, what else? Do we have any other concerns or struggles with this story so far? Oh! Okay. Literally, how many verses ahead of this?
Mark 10:31.
Okay. So, just a few verses before. Why might that be significant? You see, when we do a study in Scripture, we want to see what's before and what's after. So if he's repeating something that happened in 19, then this is probably a carryover, and I was going to get to this later, but since you brought it up and it was your question, is that it's important to look ahead and after. The reason why is because, you know, we have these things called chapters and verses. There was no such thing. When the writer was writing, it was a thought. It was a complete, you know, and yes, there are some logical breaks, but we don't have chapters and verses always in the logical breaks. You can see that throughout Scripture. Sometimes they happen to match up, and you say, oh, thank God we can just look at this chapter, and it actually is within this chapter. But most of the time we see it's before and after. So we'll come back to that in a few moments. But yeah, it's right before. It's right before. We'll look at that story here in a little bit. So the truth is this landowner fair? Now we're struggling with this a little bit. We don't want to say no that he's not fair, because you know we were saying that God is fair, right? God's fair. But then we say, but the landowner, we find out, represents God, and the landowner is not fair. Okay, we have a comment here. Thank you.
I think a lot of times we equate fairness with equal, like equal being equal. And I remember when our kids were young, I guess they're still young, but, you know, if you give one kid two cookies and then you don't give two to the next, it's like, that's not fair. Or if you tell one kid you have to go to bed at 8 and you get to stay up till 9, that's not fair. But I remember talking to a neighbor of mine, and she had 6 kids, so I was like, okay, you probably know what you're talking about. But she's like, you know, I don't treat my kids equal, but I treat them fairly. So they all get what I've determined that they need, but they don't get the same things.
And it doesn't always make sense to the kids, does it? So we've raised up a lot of really good questions, okay? A lot of really good thoughts and comments. So is it okay if I show you some of the deeper insights as we go along here, some of the finer points, if you will? Maybe that'll help us to try to wrestle with what Jesus is saying here about the character of God, because it is very important that we understand. So here's some of the fine print, okay? Here's some of the fine print. This story starts out with saying early one morning, okay? Early one morning. Now, it's interesting because sometimes we breeze right over this, but it actually has to do with the story. This was kind of this was common in that day. The farmers of that day, the way they would know it was morning is because it would start to get just a little brighter in the east, right? Just starting to come up. Everybody knew that was the cue. The day is beginning, right? So here we see that these gentlemen get there very early in the morning. They're the first workers, and they're out there in front of Home Depot just waiting for the contractors to come along and say, hey, I need your help. I don't think it happens as much here in Hawaii. Anybody pick up workers at Home Depot? All right. So this is more relevant, I think, probably to California or different places like that. People will actually kind of hang out, and you'll get to know see, Southern California, a pastor right here. You've hired several. Yeah. Yeah. And so they're there, and they're waiting for work. And when you're done with them at that work site, where are they going to be the next morning? Back at Home Depot, ready for another job. Absolutely. And so here these guys are. They're serious about it, right? They're like, nope, we're up early. We're going to get a full day's work in. We're going to get paid for today, right? They're excited. So the very first crew, I mean, they sacrificed a lot. Some of them might just be running on coffee. Some of them might have skipped breakfast. Some of them, you know, some of them sacrificed sleeping in, right? Because that's always nice to do. And then you'll notice that in verses 3, 5, and 6, it says when he comes back to the marketplace, and this is to your point, Sophia, when he comes back to the marketplace in verse 3, 5, and 6, what does he say? He says he finds men standing there, idle, not working. And what's his question to them? How come you're not working? Right? What's their reasoning? Sorry? No one hired us. Another great opportunity to say, Bologna supreme. They weren't there when he came the first time, what were they? And some of them weren't there when he came the second time. It says they were standing there idle, and their excuse is, well, nobody's hired us. What they're saying is, well, we slept in. We wanted to get our muffins and tea, you know, whatever it is. But they weren't there, clearly. Or maybe they were just like, I don't want to work so hard today. I'm going to take it easy. And so then it gets more and more preposterous as the day goes on. You know, the third hour we find is about 9 o'clock in the morning. So first thing, these workers that were there, standing, waiting, they were there at 6 in the morning. They're going to get a full day's work in, 12 hours. Okay, that's a long work day for any of us. And some of you have to work 12-hour shifts, I know. Not fun. So they're there doing this 12-hour shift, and then along come these other guys that are hired at 9 o'clock, some at noon, and then what does it say? 3, and then is it 5? 5. An hour before end of day. Peter, do you hire anybody at 5 o'clock when you're going to finish at 6?
I was just going to ask, who goes at the end of the day to hire somebody? I mean, unless I'm desperate, a pipe broke or something, I don't know, but why would I go at the end of the day to hire somebody? I'm just going to leave it alone and say, hey, tomorrow is another day, so I'll go tomorrow morning early, see who I can get, and I'm not going to go now and go at, like, in the morning, go at noon, go at 9 o'clock, go at noon. So I'm not spending my whole day just to look for people.
Look
so
for
I'm
people,
just going to
yeah.
go in the morning, and that's it. I'm done.
Yeah. No, it's good. And that's why, you know, this doesn't make sense. But it doesn't make sense, so should we listen up and say maybe there's something deeper that Jesus is trying to communicate? The answer is like, yeah, absolutely. We have a question back here.
I don't have a comment card, so
it's
actually a comment. as a farmer, if I have more to harvest, I'm going to keep reaching out for a way to have that harvest be harvested. And if that means I stay up all night, or I go, or I pray all night long for someone to get that harvest before it falls down and rots.
Yeah, yeah, no, you're right.
And often it's not about time, it is the time of the harvest.
Yes. Yeah, man, harvest time comes, and you're doing whatever it takes. In fact, sometimes they'll work around the clock if they hear a storm's coming, and they want to get that harvest in so it's not spoiling. So that's a little different than your job, isn't it? Yeah. So that's a really good insight. Thank you for pointing that out. So it's interesting. We see this phrase repeated that they were standing around in the marketplace. Now, notice that first group, they made an agreement with the landowner. Did you notice that? It's a little bit different than the agreement that he makes with the others. The first agreement he makes is what? What is it? I'm going to give you a denarius if you work for me today. Now, by the way, the denarius was actually a really good wage. Were they satisfied with him paying them a denarius? Yeah. In fact, the Roman soldiers were paid a denarius a day, and they were well paid, okay? So anybody said, oh, I'm going to make what a soldier makes today. I'm going to get out there. I'm going to work hard. Hopefully they'll hire me tomorrow, too. A denarius, that's generous. It's a very nice wage. In almost every case where it occurs in the New Testament, it's connected with the idea of a liberal wage or a large amount, okay? Notice in verse 4, something changes. He does not say how much he's going to pay them. What does it say? I will pay you, what is it? Whatever is right. I'm going to be fair. I'm going to pay you whatever's right. That means you're going to get to the end of the workday, whether you started at 9 and at noon later, right? When you get to the end of the workday, you're going to look and you're going to say, oh, great, thanks. And you're going to be on your way. That's why we don't see them complaining, right? We have a question back here. Thank you.
Is it just the human assumption, our mentality that whatever is right can be construed as your pay will be prorated to some degree. That's just an assumption that people
right.
might make.
Well, that's a good observation, yeah. We say, oh, whatever's fair, well, fair is you're paying them a denarius, so I'm going to get less than a denarius, right? Or those who agreed to the denarius, at the end of the day, they said, wait a minute, we agreed to a denarius, but they only worked an hour, they're getting a denarius. Oh, that means I'm going to get more than a denarius, right? And there's the rub. All right, we're going to come to that. All right, so notice, what did they do when they were not happy? What is it? They grumbled. You see the Greek word there. Agagazon, agagazon, agagazon. It's one of those words that's more like a poetic type thing. They grumbled and grumbled. They complained and complained and complained, right? So it's this idea that they were standing around like, oh, what have you done? How come you've done this to us? You've not done right by us. And so they're grumbling, they're complaining. Commentators really wrestle with this. Why did the landowner pay the last person he hired first before the others? If the landowner was smart, what would he have done? Quick and get rid of the guys. 6 o'clock, okay guys, whoever got here first, I'm gonna pay you first. In fact, hello, whoever's worked the longest that day wants to get home the worst, right? Get me out of here. Give me, you know, they're like, can you pay me so I can go, right? They want to get out of there. The guys that are there for an hour, they're like, whoa, we're done already? Okay, oh, I get paid. Okay, first in line. Oh, this is great, you know. So, you know, you kind of start wrapping your mind around these different details, and you're like, wow, this is really interesting. But he calls the guys that have been there an hour first, and what does he give them? You know the story. He gives them a denarius. We don't hear anything more about them. I think that pretty much shut them up quick, and they hightailed it out of there. That was great. Okay, they got a full day's wage for an hour. But we noticed that they're grumbling. So why did this landowner do it this way? If he had let those guys go that he hired first and gave them their agreed-upon denarius and they were gone, they would have lived happily and never had an issue. So there's a reason why the story goes this way, right? He wants them to see. And of course, this is a parable. This isn't a true story. This is something Jesus made up to give the point that he was making. Notice what his answer is. They're grumbling about what the landowner has done, and the landowner responds with what? How does he respond? Are you seeing it there in your word? Oh, we have a comment in the back. He says, take what is yours, but I wish to give this last man the same as you. Take what's yours, but I want to give this person the same. Yes?
I think all these are examples of supply and demand. It's a method of society. And usually, you deal with agreements by contract. Mm. So it's variations of supply and demand.
Okay, yeah. So he had made an agreement with them. So he's basically quieting their grumbling by saying, hey, look, I gave you what we agreed on. If I want to get, I can pay them whatever I want. It's mine to give. So be on your way. Interestingly enough, it sounds like they were reluctant to actually take the pay until they had the conversation. So it wasn't like they received it and then they started arguing. It was kind of like either, you know, we don't know for sure. We don't know if they just let it kind of fall on the ground or if it was just kind of sitting on the table in front of them. We don't have that framework. But it sounds like they had not taken up the payment yet. And so he says, take it and be on your way, right? Take it and go. Notice in verse 14, where is the focus? Verse 14, what do you see there? What's the focus? What's the focal point? Take what's yours, go your way. I wish to give to this last man the same as to you. What matters?
Yeah.
Is it, you know, if you were a photographer, this would be the focal point. You'd zoom right in on this. In this whole story, what matters the most? You'd zoom right in on it.
Well, I think in the story, the workers are focusing on themselves, and this is more a reflection of the landowner. The landowner made a decision that he had this to give, and he was going to give this, just like Christ has eternity to give, and he's going to give it to those that worked their whole life and were baptized when they were 12 or 13. And there's going to be some 11th hour baptisms that are going to happen on their deathbed, and like the thief on the cross, and he's still going to get eternal life.
Yeah, and isn't that so amazing? We start looking at it through those eyes, and we see in verse 14, he says, hey, take what's yours and go, but I'm going to do what I want to do with what I have to give. Don't tell me how to use what I have, right? That's where the camera zooms in, takes a snapshot of the character of God. That's the God that we serve. Aren't I allowed to do whatever I want? You know, if I want to be generous with these people, what's it to you? This is the entire point of Christ's story here about the landowner, who, of course, is God. And we'll come back to this in a few moments. But notice in verse 15, what does he point out about the grumblers and complainers? What does he say? What illustration does he use? Oh, do we have a comment here? Oh, sorry.
I was just going to say, I think the people, the one that agreed the denarius, they expected a lot. But the people who just agreed, they didn't like expect anything. They just were happy to have a job. They were just happy to be blessed, and they didn't expect things. But I think the people that worked all day, they expected more, like more blessings, if you do it in the spiritual aspect, I guess.
Right.
They expected more. That's all I wanted to say.
And that was the complaint, right? We've been here all day. We worked through the heat of the day. They mentioned, yeah. The focus is on them, right? All right. And so Jesus tries to bring it back around to saying, no, it's about the landowner, not the workers. Yeah.
Probably if I was the last person that came work, and I got paid that much, knowing what the going rate is, like, I know for the day usually it's that much, and then I came, I work for an hour, and I get this, I'm thinking, bro, how much this other guy gets? If I get this, what if I missed today, you know? Today I missed a lot, because I could have banked. But, you know, this man is generous. I never worked for somebody to pay me this much in one day. This man is generous. You know, that's what I would think, you know, from that.
Yeah, that's a really, really great point. Yeah.
Yeah, like going off of Peter's comment, like thinking about it, if I worked like hardly like an hour, but still got a full day's pay from like my like Lord like that, I'd be super thankful. Because it's like, man, I didn't do anything, but I just got like the best thing in the world. Like, I know I don't deserve this amount, but he's just giving it to me.
And that's where we have to check our hearts, because if we're on the flip side of that, if we're the ones that have put in a lot of the work and the blood and sweat and tears and sacrificed, we expect more. But then what does that mean? That means we probably should check our hearts, because if we're doing it out of a heart of gratitude and thanksgiving toward, we know, the goodness of the landowner, then we don't see it as laboring for something, right? We've already received the something. Therefore, it comes out of the goodness of our hearts. We have a comment back here. I'll get it to him.
To take it one step further, I think the person that came last and got what the others got that were before him is that he would hopefully look at that and say, I was blessed and I will bless others.
Great observation. If you are one of those that has been blessed,
And it's interesting because, again, man before your time, because here in a couple moments, we're going to look back at chapter 19, and we're going to tie that together really beautifully. Yes?
So this isn't my thought. I read it from Morris Vendon, but he was saying, actually, the first workers, the first crew, they actually did get more. So if you're comparing this to the landowner being God and doing work for God, you got more time with him. You got a whole lifetime with the landowner. I'm sorry, the whole work day with the landowner, and the people who came at the end just got that 1 hour. When I was younger, I used to think, man, look at the thief on the cross. He literally does whatever he wants, has a great old time. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
And then he slips in at the very end, and he's going to be up in heaven. I want to be one of those people. I don't want to have to live the straight and narrow all my life. Mm-hmm. And as I get older, I realize, like, no, that the definition of good and what's a good life, this is the good life. This right. is the blessed life. You want more of this as soon as you can get it. Mm.
So in other words, maybe part of what we've avoided too, we've avoided the pain of chasing after the thing that we think they're getting away with or enjoying, which in fact, it got them nailed to a cross, right? The thief, we don't think about that sometimes. We think, oh yeah, he just got to live whatever life he wanted to. Well, look where it took him. And think about the pain that he experienced in that path to get there. Yeah, good. Okay, a couple quick comments back here and then we're gonna have to wrap it up. This is fun. And look, you're not gonna be done. Hopefully this is just getting your wheels turning, getting your juices flowing. Please, in the back.
So my question is, as a worker, who am I working for and why am I working? Am I working for money or am I working for God?
What does the prosperity gospel say? Oh, don't answer that. Okay, thank you. We have one more comment right here and then we're gonna have to wrap things up. Thanks, Ethan.
The lesson talked about God, man's wisdom and God's wisdom. If I read the Bible with my own wisdom, I'll be looking at that story as a story of workers' rights. If I let the Holy Spirit guide me, I'll see God.
Right,
and
right.
That's the difference.
And that's how he wants us to see it, right? Because truly, we've already said this doesn't make any sense. This landowner is not being fair. So what does that tell us about the character of God? That he's not fair when we look at it from the outside, okay? So, again, we already mentioned this, but what are the greatest challenges when we start applying this kingdom tale? What are some of the challenges that we have? We already mentioned this. There's not chapters and verses, so we have to go back to chapter 19. What do you see in chapter 19? Put on your seatbelts. We're going to rip through this in just a few moments. What do you see in chapter 19 that would apply to this landowner and the workers? Play along for another moment or two. What do you think? What do you see? Peter asks a question. Okay. What will we get? Now notice, we back up a little farther, we have the rich young ruler. Okay. And what is his question? What must I do? Again, where is the focus? I. Where is the focus of the people that we see, the workers that we see in chapter 20? I. So Jesus is really giving some response to what this rich young ruler's question was, but we got to follow it up here because that's his question. Fighting the wind. So that's his question. Teacher, good teacher, what good thing shall I do? And Jesus tells him to do what? Go sell all that you have, right? And give it to the poor. Everything that you've earned, do what with it? Give it away. Does that make more sense now when we look at chapter 20? Everything that you've worked so hard for, give it away. And that was a great comment that you made earlier, right? When we've been so blessed by God, what do we do with it?
Hey man, when you look at the book of Acts, it's quite a socialist book. It says that those that were rich were helping those that weren't, and they all pretty much had the same thing. We don't want to hear that today, because that's a little hard. We like our things, okay? But they lived pretty much a socialistic lifestyle, where they said, hey, I don't want to have more than you. I want you to be blessed like I've been blessed. God's blessed me with this, and so he expects that I'm going to give this away to you so that we can all live comfortably, okay? So it's interesting when we start looking at the character of God that way. Yeah, so we have the rich young ruler's question. He gives the response. Notice, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Then Jesus said to his disciples in verse 23, assuredly I say to you that it's hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And again I say to you, it's easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Why is it that it's hard for a rich man? Because he has the mentality of this rich young ruler, that if I work hard, I can get what I want. Oh, and by the way, Jesus, what do I have to do to get heaven? Do you see? It's a complete twist of the mind. He thinks that there's something that he can do to earn God's favor. And then we see in chapter 20, Jesus tells this story. And the workers get what they did not deserve. Get rid of all you've earned, all of your possessions, and accept my free gift, is Jesus' response to this rich young ruler. And by the way, share this free gift with everyone else, whether they've been working their lives or for an hour. Be liberal with love. Because heaven is great and we look forward to heaven. That's like the pinnacle, right? We get so excited about what we're going to experience in heaven. But sometimes we get so concerned, because heaven is our goal, we get so concerned about trying to make sure that we're ready, that we're going to get that prize at the end, that we miss the mission of Christ here on this earth. Because we're what? Just like the workers in the vineyard. We're worried about us being ready, and we lose sight of God's mission. Sometimes we get so concerned making sure that we're ready, and we spend all of our time trying to polish ourselves to get ready for heaven. We gotta get all these rough edges and all of that, but I want to challenge you with something. Weren't the disciples rough around the edges? Just a little bit. So if we spend all of our time trying to polish our rough edges, Jesus is going to come before we even do anything, before we even share the gospel that we've received from him. So he's not saying to get yourself right. He's saying, come to me now. I'll polish you in the process. That's not your problem. What I need you to do is to share this good gift that I've given you. Don't hold it for yourself. Give it away. Make sure that everyone else knows that my kingdom is not like this world. It's something much, much different. Notice those that were standing idle in the marketplace. Does he chastise them? He asks, what are you doing? Like, how come you haven't been working? Right? But when they give him this lame excuse, which is, again, it's not true, okay? When he gives them this lame excuse, he doesn't skip a beat. He doesn't say, you know what, forget you. Come back tomorrow and we'll try again. Get here a little earlier, please. He doesn't do that, right? He says, where have you been? Oh, well, you know, we're just sitting here waiting, like trying to get some work, right? It's all right, come on, let's go. He doesn't skip a beat. He wants them in his vineyard. You see, there's nothing greater than being in heaven with God. And Jesus calls us to be generous. I'll never forget, my mom, we were in
in a mall parking lot, and there was a woman who came past our car, and she had a gas can, an empty gas can, and she said, "Oh, my car is broken down. I need some gas." And my mom gave her $20, which was a lot back then. This is probably, 30 years ago. But the reason why I remember it, it was etched in my memory because my mom gave her $20. That would have filled up her whole car, not just a gas can. And wouldn't you know it, we walked out the other side of the mall and the same lady was going to another car trying to get money for gas. It just never made sense to me in my mind. And for a long time I thought, my mom totally got conned on that. What was that about? Like, doesn't she know better? Like, she's an adult. I'm just thinking this in my mind. Like, didn't she know this lady was just going from car to car collecting money? That's what it means to have the heart of Christ. What does it mean to have the heart of Christ? What does it mean to love people the way that God loves people? It means that you know that you're going to be taken advantage of, but you won't stop doing it. You're going to keep on keeping on. It means that you know that people will con you, but you're not going to stop. You know that they will sometimes even get what they don't deserve. We've all heard stories of people that make more money than us that stand on the corner. They walk around the corner, get into their nice car, and drive to their nicer house. I know this firsthand. I saw it. I was warned by the police department. That guy stands there, he makes more money than you make in 2 years. And Jesus says, who cares? Are you okay with that? Are you okay with that? When Jesus healed hundreds and thousands of people in his time here on this earth, and he looked down from the cross, who did he see? Were they there? Were they there cheering Jesus on? Appreciative of what he was doing for them? Realizing that he was who he said he was, and he was the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Not many. What he looked down on, he saw the mocking crowd, those who were jeering, those who were making fun of him, unthankful for the very gift that he was procuring for them, the gift of salvation and eternal life. They were literally putting nails through his hands and through his feet. What held him on the cross, as you know, was his love, his generosity, giving a full day's wage to the man who hung on the cross next to him, who did not deserve it. That was the God that we serve. He was willing in spite of it all. Why was he willing? Why was he willing to do that? Because Christ is unfair. He gives to people who do not deserve it. He's going to pay us what he wants to, not what we deserve. All you have to do is accept this gift. All you have to do is say yes to Jesus. And then let that gift, that free gift, change your heart to becoming the generous person that God has created you to be. Is that your desire today? Maybe some of you, you've heard this message before, but you just want to make that recommitment to God. God, I want to be all in. I want to be generous. I know maybe that I've been like that field worker, that person that got up early and I put all in and I've become resentful. Lord, heal my heart. Make me generous again. Glad when the last worker comes in. Can you imagine coming the next day and being the person that comes in at 5 o'clock? And yeah, you were there at 6 o'clock, but you see somebody coming in at 5 and you're like, dude, you don't know how lucky you are. You are blessed beyond measure. You barely slipped in. But praise the Lord, our landowner is good. He loves you so much, he's got the same reward waiting for you. Is that your desire? Maybe you're one of those that has slipped in at 5 and you're saying, praise the Lord, hallelujah. I'm late in life. Whatever it is, I hope that this message pierces through to your very soul today. that you can have, out of the generosity of God, that you can have that same generous spirit as well.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, help us to have your generous love that you have shown us. Thank you for dying on the cross because you love us, each one of us, so much. Not because of what we have done, not because who we are, but you just love us unconditionally. Thank you for that love. Help us to share that love as we go out in the world and live our daily life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay. Let's all sing our last song.
Yes, Lord, give us your peace that passes human understanding as we leave here today. May we leave here with the Spirit of the Lord living inside of us. May we be gracious beyond measure. May we be unfair as you have been unfair to us. And